Good morning, Your Honors. Please, the court. I'm Peter Goldstein. I represent the appellant in this case, who now is Gerald Napauk, and the estate of Lloyd Napauk. We have raised numerous jury questions, and the only way that the district court found otherwise, in my opinion, was to make its own personal findings on disputed facts, even contrary to the undisputed facts, the evidence that we presented in the opposition to the motion for summary judgment. The determination as to whether the force used was reasonable under the Fourth Amendment requires a very careful balancing of the intrusion into the individual's Fourth Amendment.
Can I not to jump ahead, because I think we may have to come back to the constitutional violation, but as to the clearly established prong, because you agree we can affirm the district court, this is on summary judgment, so we can affirm the district court on alternative basis if we need to.
I do not think that we can.
Okay.
And I believe that the case law that we cited, let me make a distinction here.
My question was actually more basic.
Okay.
We're reviewing this summary judgment grant de novo. Even if we think that the district court might have gotten some things wrong, if there is an alternative basis to affirm the district court's decision, we can do that, right? That seems to be pretty basic. Okay.
Yes,
so I want to ask you about clearly established law, because you seem to, setting aside whether there was prong one violation of the Constitution, you seem to rely on two cases. One, the Glenn case from 2011, and then the 2013
case.
The Hayes.
Yeah.
Yeah. So the problem, number one, Hayes, help me understand how that helps you, because Hayes said there was no constitutional violation. It said there were, the panel was split on whether there were tort, whether there was a factual dispute that would have warranted a tort claim under California law. So how can that be clearly established as to a constitutional violation when the case said there was no constitutional violation?
Well, I think that case, in the Hayes case, it was a discussion about California negligence law primarily, not too much the excessive force.
Okay, so you're basically conceding that cannot serve as a basis for clearly established law on a Fourth Amendment violation.
I think it's a very specific factual determination in this case.
I just want to know whether there's clearly established law here. And I think what I'm hearing is that the Hayes case cannot be one of those cases. So then you go to the 2011 case, and here's the question I have. The 2011 case was reversed because of factual disputes. It did not find a constitutional violation. It said that there were factual disputes that precluded summary judgment. Do we have case law that says that a case such as that did not find a constitutional violation but just said there were disputes of material fact can serve as clearly established law for a future violation?
Well, there are factual disputes in this case, and we believe that have to...
Not my question.
Okay.
You keep going to prong one, which we may have to get to.
Right.
I'm asking about prong two, the clearly established law. I don't see any clearly established law here. And if that's true, then why can't we just affirm based on prong two and say there was no prior clearly established law in this case?
Well, I don't think this is not an exact parallel with the Hayes case. I mean, there are factual issues that have to be decided.
Hayes doesn't help you.
No, I'm not contending.
Yeah, we don't need to talk about Hayes. The whole point of clearly established law is officers on the ground should be advised that the action they're going to take is unconstitutional. What case tells these officers that in firing on Mr. Napauk in these circumstances, they would be violating a clearly established prior precedent? I don't see it. I don't see us ever holding that this was a violation, that these similar facts. To the contrary, Hayes suggests that it wasn't a violation.
Well, what about the Glenn case, for example?
I'm talking about. Glenn, that's my question.
Yeah.
In Glenn, we didn't say it was a constitutional violation. We said there's a factual dispute. about whether there's a violation. How can subsequent officers rely on this factual dispute and ferret out what action is prohibited and what is not?
I really don't know if there is a specific case right on point in this exact scenario that we can point to. But what about the Nahad case, in which the officers mistook a pen for a knife or a sharp object?
Okay, that's a different issue on the mistake, and maybe we need to talk about that too. Well,
can I follow up on your colloquy with Judge Nelson? Hayes, the state claim was analyzed under it's the same analysis of objective reasonableness, and they were applying the Graham factors for reasonableness. So it's the same analysis, and it was so. Why isn't that? I'm surprised that you're retreating from Hayes, because I take it to be clearly established law that when someone has a knife, it doesn't mean that an officer can automatically shoot and kill the person. It depends on the reasonableness factors that are applied in Graham and subsequent cases. So why wouldn't Hayes be clearly established law that could be applicable to this case?
I think it could be. And in the Hayes case, he was branded. He was holding the weapon in a very threatening manner. In this case, in a Pauk, it was behind him. It was down. He was holding it with his two fingers and thumb.
And haven't we had other published Ninth Circuit authorities that are 1983 cases that also speak and rely on Hayes as relevant precedent for considering the reasonableness of lethal force as well?
Yes.
I think Glenn, in fact, cited Hayes, and there may be other cases as well.
Well, Glenn was 2011. It might be a different one.
Oh, okay.
Yeah, I mean, if you want to make the parallel with Nahad case, for example, Glenn is the principal case, but you go back to prong one again of the analysis. In this case, in this specific case, and I think all these cases really do rise or fall based on the very intricate facts that are involved. And in this case,
that hurts you when it comes to clearly established law. Because if it is so fact specific, then it's hard to find that the law was clearly established. It might help you on the first prong, and I want to ask you about this, because setting aside my arguments on the constitutional one, we do have state law claims here. We have a Nevada state law battery claim and a Nevada state law negligence claim. What do we do with those claims? Because so in the Tabaris case, California law had clearly said state law is far more liberal on granting relief than the Fourth Amendment. I'm not sure what Nevada law is on this. The best I could find was a District Court of Nevada case, Ramirez, that suggested that they're coextensive, that the Fourth Amendment analysis is the same as the Nevada state law battery analysis for purposes of state law. Do you have anything to add to that?
Well, the Nevada negligence claim is similar to the California negligence claim. I mean, you've got to have a duty.
Okay, that's negligence.
Yeah.
I was asking about battery, because Ramirez addressed battery and I think suggested, if I read it right, that Nevada battery is the same analysis in these circumstances as the civil rights claim, which I read, I think, to mean that it would be coextensive with the Fourth Amendment analysis. What I think is sort of what Judge Sanchez was suggesting, that
the only difference is no qualified immunity in the battery.
Well, I think that's right. I don't know, but that's my I haven't been able to find that there is qualified immunity.
I mean, and of course, the Nevada negligence and state law claims don't really provide a remedy in these cases, because they're capped.
Why?
They're capped at.
Yeah, but that's still a remedy.
It's a remedy, but it's certainly not sufficient for the life of a human being. But no, I understand.
Well, hold on. It's inherently sufficient for the life of a human being under Nevada law. That's what the legislature said.
Well, he's saying I think that it's like $250,000 tort cap. Is that right? $250,000 tort cap, and you're saying a life is worth much more than that. So is that?
I think at the time it was $100,000.
Yes, so it goes back.
Well, no, but I understand your point, but I'm just saying the state law defines that. You know, you may be, you may not like it, you may want more money, but I don't know how you can, I mean, but state law has defined the right.
Correct.
Yeah, so.
I mean, it's been.
So you're just saying you want to go above the cap, and that's why you want the state cap.
Well, of course, and now, since this case was decided by the district court, there is a Nevada constitutional violation that, in a case, Mack v. Williams, that provides a private right of action for litigants arising under the Nevada constitutional violation. So there's more remedies now available to litigants in Nevada than simply.
But you couldn't take advantage of that, right?
No, not.
Even if it remanded. Can I ask about the substantive due process claim?
Sure.
Because you have a substantive due process claim for. Mr. Napook was, how old was he? He was like
44 when he died.
44 years old.
Yes.
So we do have case law in the Ninth Circuit. I've written on this.
I read
in the Sinclair case.
Tabaris, yes.
Yeah. Well, Tabaris is a separate one. In the Sinclair case, I've written on the on the substantive due process claim. And it is true, as we said in Sinclair, that we are an outlier court that has recognized that adult children can give rise to a substantive due process claim. My question is, where is the limit? Because I think in Sinclair, we're dealing with an 18 or a 19-year-old adult who at least was not a minor, who was living at home. But I wrote about this in Sinclair and said, how far does this go? I mean, it doesn't make sense to say that. I mean, what if it's a 60-year-old child and he has 80-year-old parents? Is the same substance? We have not held in this similar circumstance that the substantive due process right applies, have we?
No, I agree with you. The substantive due process claim is not the principal claim in this case. It's the Fourth Amendment derivative claim of Mr. Lloyd Napook, who died, passed away. His father is now the successor for all intents and purposes. But yes, the substantive due process claim is secondary to...
Low on the totem pole.
I think it's low on the totem pole. I agree with Your Honor on that. You've written on that, Sinclair, and it's a more questionable claim.
Okay.
I mean, even if it did apply, assuming it did apply, I was having trouble seeing any, you know, where deliberate indifference might come in, and if not, if this was more of a snap judgment decision, why there was any, you know, purpose to harm, any evidence of that in the officer's actions.
Yeah, well, we're looking at the objective state of the, looking at the video, and I know Your Honors have seen the video in this case. They had certainly time to deliberate. I mean, they had 5 minutes out there to assess Mr. Napook's mental condition, to assess his ability to cooperate with their commands, to assess his movements, any furtive gestures. So when they have that time to deliberate, to assess him, they have backup. They've got the air unit that's been there for 2 minutes. They had Sergeant Chudoba, who had a less lethal shotgun that was getting out of his vehicle that can be seen in the officer gun's body cam. So they knew the backup was there. They knew the air unit was there, and they knew other officers were about to arrive at the scene. So they had time to deliberate on what to do, and yet they shot him anyway, when he really was not a credible threat, an immediate credible threat to them.
Would you agree? I mean, the reasonableness analysis is different than a deliberate indifference analysis. Would you agree? I would seem to think that deliberate indifference is a higher bar to meet than whether the officer's actions were reasonable or unreasonable, or do you disagree with
that? No, as I said to Judge Nelson, I agree. That's the secondary claim, really. It's a substantive due process claim. It's a much tougher standard to show the deliberate indifference and the purpose to harm, which I can't necessarily say exist in this case. Although Mr. Napook was shot in the head, among the 7 shots that were fired, 5 impacted his body, one of which was to the head. So arguably that was an intent to harm beyond and above just eliminating the threat of Mr. Napook, who I don't believe even was a threat. And I think getting back to my original point is that these facts are so important that we weigh them carefully, and I don't believe the district court's order considered all the facts in our favor in the light most favorable to the non-moving party, which is the plaintiff, the appellant. us. And we've got a situation where numerous two people at least called and said, there's a man with a large tool or a crowbar or a Slim Jim. They had no initial impression that he had committed any crime. When they first approached him, they approached him from 15 feet away, is where Officer Gunn stopped his vehicle, which is too close. So the whole idea of officers dealing with a person...
Too close because there's a policy on that, or...?
There is a policy on
that. And did it violate the policy?
Yeah, there
is
were...
Is that part of... That's your Monell claim?
Yeah, that's part of the Monell claim, but there were policy violations found by the Office of Internal Oversight that the approach... The approach was within policy, they determined. However, the lack of pre-planning was out of policy. There was no pre-planning at all done, and there was no communication.
How were they supposed to do pre-planning? They were responding. I mean, as I understood it, the two officers showed up independently. It's not like they even went together. They just showed up independently. But what pre-planning would have been necessary or appropriate?
How are we going to, you know, at least a communication between the officers that are on their way, you know, in this case, Sergeant Kenton and Officer Gunn. Communications between them, and then other communications to dispatch, which ultimately did alert dispatch to get the air unit involved and the other immediate action team to come. So there was communication.
Okay.
There simply wasn't communication between the two officers, and that's the key. They never spoke to each other. Sorry, my mouth is getting a little dry, but they never spoke to each other during the entire interaction.
Okay.
Except one comment by Officer Gunn to Sergeant Kenton. But Sergeant Kenton... that he was communicating in his mind, in his deposition. I mean, but he did not communicate. So they were faulted for failing to communicate with each other.
Okay.
Having a
counsel, you're over time. We're gonna give you some time for rebuttal. But I think, unless there's other questions at this point, I think we'll give you time for rebuttal.
Thank you, Your
Honor. Thank you, counsel.
Thank you.
You've still got time for rebuttal, counsel. You might not want to leave.
Oh, I'm sorry.
Yeah, you can't quit. May it please the court. Craig Anderson on behalf of Officer Gunn, Sergeant Kenton, and the Las Vegas Metropolitan Police Department. Briefly to address the state law claims, there is an unpublished Nevada Supreme Court decision, Estate of Brennes, B-R-E-N-E-S, which does apply the Graham factors to a battery claim.
To a battery claim.
Yes, to a battery claim.
So, see, and that's what I'm worried about. So I think we have to address, effectively we have to address whether there was a constitutional violation here. Even though we have discretion whether to do that under the Fourth Amendment claims, I think we still have to do the same analysis under the battery claim no matter
what. Yes, under the battery claim. I would agree with you that because Nevada, when it comes to an intentional tort of a battery claim or an excessive force claim, they're kind of the same thing. They're duplicative.
Can I ask, does the battery claim, does it matter whether it's battery wrongful death versus a different kind of battery claim? Was this a state of relish claim about wrongful death?
It's the same because police officers are privileged to use force, and so a battery claim is essentially an excessive force claim. There's lots of case law out there. Not in Nevada necessarily, but that does say that an excessive.
What about the negligence claim? How is that different? Because it seems to me, I mean, in Tabarez, we had case law in California that said negligence, state law negligence is far more expansive than the Fourth Amendment, which seems intuitive, but I wasn't able to find anything in Nevada.
And there is not. Okay, so you cannot have a negligent use of intentional force, and that's an Arizona case, Napier, N-A-P-I-E-R. And so what a negligence claim looks at is whether the pre-shooting, pre-force decisions perhaps caused, you know, the otherwise justifiable use of force. In Nevada, we have discretionary immunity under NRS 41.032, which, according to the cases, an officer is immune for their pre-shooting decisions unless they show bad faith or deliberate indifference. And that would be the Davis...
Under negligence,
yes. That.
But that's odd because that suggests that negligence is a higher standard under Nevada state law than battery.
Well, so you cannot get immunity under Nevada state law for an intentional tort. You know, if you're not immune if you
violate. Right, but you're suggesting that negligence requires deliberate indifference, almost like the familial, the substantive due process claim.
Yes, if you're going to, they're immune unless their actions showed bad faith or a willful disregard, I think is the correct term. And that's Jones versus Las Vegas Metropolitan Police Department and Davis versus City of Las Vegas. And so when you're looking at pre-shooting tactics, the pre-planning, that sort of a thing, they're immune for those decisions unless their actions show some, there's evidence of bad faith or a willful disregard for the individual's rights.
I thought the discretionary immunity involved not these sorts of actions, but some involving something more policy-making or something a little bit different than patrol officers on the ground.
So the decision.
But you're saying these cases specifically refer to officer actions arriving on the scene.
In use of force cases.
In use of force.
Yes, and so the decision of how to detain someone. So for example, I mean, bad hypothetical probably, but if there's someone inside of a store, do they go in, do they not go in? You don't want officers making those decisions based on the fear of liability. You know, someone waving a gun at a store, you know, well, if we go in, we're going to get sued. If we don't, so what they're looking at is whether the decisions to that they used were evidence of bad faith or willful disregard. And so Jones versus Las Vegas Metropolitan Police Department was an officer, officers who tased a suspect multiple times. Davis versus City of Las Vegas was an officer who punched a suspect in the face. There's a couple of others. So on how to perform a detention is discretionary, because it does involve socioeconomic and political considerations of the officer, and you don't want officers refusing to act because of fear of civil liability. And so that's where NRS 41.
And the cases say, they say what you're saying, or you're extrapolating from the cases?
Jones versus Las Vegas Metropolitan Police Department does say that that you do need bad faith or willful disregard of it, and then so does Davis versus City of Las Vegas. Those are Ninth Circuit cases. They're not Nevada State cases, okay, that have interpreted NRS 41032 in excessive force cases.
Okay, so let's get back to my questions on clearly established.
Okay.
Hayes was not a Fourth Amendment case. It said there was no Fourth Amendment violation. Is it true that we have looked to Hayes for clearly established law on that principle?
Okay, I could be wrong, but I believe what Hayes said is there was not standing for a Fourth Amendment claim. And so Hayes looked at the California state law claims through the prism of the Fourth Amendment Graham factors. And so Hayes did not address whether the law was clearly established, but it did address, for, I would say, for Fourth Amendment purposes, whether it was reasonable. So it would be, I would say, that I would have to distinguish Hayes from this case, which I think is easy to do.
Okay, so we can't distinguish Hayes by just saying it didn't address the Fourth Amendment, therefore it can't be clearly established. We've got to walk through the merits of Hayes.
The truth is I believe Hayes did address the Fourth Amendment. They just did it under the prism of California state law, but they never looked at the clearly established prong because they said there's no standing
Where I struggle with that is California has been clear that state law is more expansive than the Fourth Amendment. So I don't understand logically how you could use an analysis, because this was certified to the California Supreme Court. They weren't looking at the Fourth Amendment. They were only looking at state law. So I don't understand how you could take a state law that has already been defined as more expansive than the Fourth Amendment and say that that could be clearly established for the Fourth Amendment.
So I think your best case on that, again, dealing with California law, is the Voss case, V-O-S. That's where there was a guy with scissors in a store, and they ended up shooting him. And then they found it was not a Fourth Amendment violation, but that it could proceed under California state law because of the broad scope.
And that's my point.
So what we're looking at with the Fourth Amendment is the actions of the suspect at the time force was used. And so in this case, was it reasonable to shoot Mr. Napook when he was within 8 feet advancing with what the officers thought was a deadly weapon? Under California state law, you're looking at the totality of the circumstances. Did you provoke him into making that bad decision? You know, were your commands too aggressive? Did you consider his mental health? So that's where it's broader, is that California law, at least, allows a look at whether the officers could have handled the situation differently, whether they could have...
California law looks
California
like.
Law.
But Nevada is different.
And that's where the discretionary immunity comes in for Nevada law.
Look, help me out here just on a broader point. You watch this video. It's troubling. This is tragic what happened. And we see these. It's not unusual. We see these, sadly. And I always struggle in these cases between, I mean, we've got this command not to look at 2020 hindsight, because it's easy to look at it and say, oh, they could have done something differently. They should have done something differently. But here, it just doesn't feel as threat. When you're watching the video, it doesn't feel as threatening as a lot of the other cases that we've seen in these scenarios. So what about this suggests that there was no underlying constitutional violation?
What about this is that there, you know, this was a 5-minute period, which of course in police work is quite a long time. You know, usually it's a 5-second, right. 10-second, and someone's dead. In this case, there were 5 minutes of commands, 5 minutes of clear instructions to drop the weapon, 5 seconds of clear instructions not to advance. And here, what the officers did correctly is they never provoked him, they never advanced on him. They were simply attempting to contain him until they could get their low lethal, which they requested, and goes a little bit into the pre-planning, that they requested a canine, they requested a beanbag shotgun, they were actively just attempting
to... Remind me, did they have tasers?
They did have tasers.
And why they weren't used, because the situation didn't allow it, or what was the justification?
So in a case where an officer is confronting someone with a deadly weapon, there would be two options here, both to remain on lethal force, which is what the officers did, or one, to have a taser with cover of with lethal force. There's not a situation where you would just use a taser. You would need a lethal force option in this. So,
and it's not even clear. Oh, go ahead.
I was going to say, but you have that here, and as I read the record, Officer Gunn, I believe, testified that he thought that now I'm forgetting the sergeant's name.
Kenton.
That the sergeant had the taser and might deploy it. So I guess at a minimum, why doesn't this raise tribal questions about? I also was very troubled by this video. It's very tragic, and you could tell that the officers were trying to talk Mr. Napauk down. But to me, what seems to be maybe the turning point in this is, could they have done some more strategic retreating? Could they have done other things to try to contain the situation? They had the air support. I think you had another sergeant that had already arrived with the shotgun, with the bean bags. Should this be an issue left to the jury to decide whether something else could have happened as this tragic situation unfolded?
And I would concede that the taser is probably the most difficult part of this case, that one of them could have been on taser. But the case law is that you don't have to use the least intrusive. It just has to be reasonableness. And so it still was reasonable for each officer to have their lethal option out. It may not have been the best practice. You may think in hindsight that it would have been better to have someone on taser, but it was not unreasonable.
Would taser have even worked? I mean, the Tavares case, which I handled, he was tasered. It didn't do a dang thing to him. And he was on, I believe he was on meth as well. Now, the officers didn't know, but they knew something was wrong with him. I mean, is there a justification that in the circumstance like this, a taser can't be used? Or it should be used. It may not work. We got to recognize that, but we should still use that first.
Taser is a viable option. However, there's a lot of insecurity with a taser. You know, they do not always work. They're not, foolproof. And so that's left up to the officer, and that's where we look at, okay, we wish he had used a taser, but was it unreasonable to be on gun facing this threat? And the answer would be no. It is still reasonable.
Well, this is my question, because you may very well be right that it was reasonable, but I don't know that it is beyond debate. And so this comes back to the summary judgment standard, and I have worries that the district court may have misapplied the summary judgment standard, because the court had concluded a reasonable officer would have done this, when the analysis should be, no reasonable juror would find, or in other words, a reasonable juror could find for the plaintiff for summary judgment. So why, it may be reasonable that the officers couldn't have gone to tasers or may not have been, but why isn't this a triable question? What makes it beyond debate in this circumstance? Well, in your view?
Because when you're looking at reasonableness, you're looking at a large zone of reasonableness. And we can sit here, you know, all of us all day and say, well, they could have done this, they could have retreated, you know, but then, of course, what if he tripped over the speed bump? What, you know, and we can play that game all day long, which is what we do in these cases. The easy answer for me for your question is there is no clearly established law that said this.
But that doesn't help us under state battery law.
Correct. And so that's my fallback on the Fourth Amendment claim, is that you would not find any clearly established law. But I would think you'd have to find that it was unreasonable the way the officers behaved in this matter, that it was unreasonable for both of them to stay on gun.
Well, so then in that case, distinguish Hayes from me, because I do think that is applicable law. And you've got a situation there where you're actually in an enclosed environment within a home and someone is advancing, knife pointed down, and they're shot. So, you know, in fact, it seems a little more heightened there, and yet the court found that this was a triable question on reasonableness. So why is that not clearly established law for purposes of this case?
So Hayes is quite easy to distinguish, because when the officers enter the kitchen, you have a wall between them, and they enter simultaneously. Their instructions to Hayes are, show us your hands. His hands are behind his back. And he does. He complies with the command. He just happens to have a knife in his hand. So when he raises his hands, as they've requested him to do, and they see the knife, they shoot him. But he was complying with the commands, and plus he had uttered a statement similar. I'm not getting a direct quote here, but if you're going to take me to jail, take me to jail. Napook is completely different. Napook did not comply with any of the simple commands to drop the knife. They did not comply with the commands to stop. When they asked him questions, his answers were not aggressive with them, but they were not compliant. And so Hayes, the court found it was different because he was complying with the command when he showed him the knife. He raised his hands as he was asked to do, and they shot him for doing that. So they shot him for following their commands.
Fair enough. Let me ask this. There are other factors here that would suggest it might be more of a tribal question. He never threatens the officers. He never points this object at them or waves it or charges at them. I think there's variable speed shown in the video. Mm-hmm. Sometimes he's slow. Sometimes he's advancing on them a little bit more quickly. But it's not like some of these other cases that we've had where people are rushing on the officers and they have to make a split-second decision. So is it your view that just because there's that difference about the officer command that it doesn't become clearly established, that somehow it's... You know, explain that for me, because we have to wrestle oftentimes with, it has to be specific enough to give clear instruction to the officers in the future, but no case is ever going to be an identical match. So how do we draw that line in your view?
So the jurisprudence, to me, as far as reasonableness goes, not clearly established, but reasonable, is if someone is advancing on an officer with a potential deadly weapon and ignoring lawful commands, courts have always held that it was reasonable to shoot. And in a state of Serrano, Yerera Serrano, it was an elderly, heavyset woman who was limping, and they shot her at about 12 feet.
That was unpublished, though, right?
It was unpublished, correct. But it was 2020, and so, you know, because it's the same as the Watkins case. But, yeah, so when someone is advancing, ignoring commands, the courts, when they get to within a, you know, I mean, it goes as far as 55 feet, which seems a little bit even long to me. But in this case, they were within 8 feet, 9 feet of when they shot. He's ignoring commands. He's advancing. The cases have all held that as a reasonable...
Well, I wouldn't say all, because, again, Hayes, he was advancing without any... Well, I guess not ignoring commands, because there was no command. But, you know, for example, Crawford versus the City of Bakersfield, you have that's the case, the mental health case, where the person was setting himself on fire, potentially others. He had this bike lock over his head, and he was advancing on officers, and he was shot, and that was a tribal dispute. And so even if you have someone advancing on an officer, I'm not sure that it would necessarily mean that you have a carte blanche to shoot. You know, Glenn, the young man, was not advancing on officers, but was advancing in the direction of the home where his parents were, and they shot him, and as Judge Nelson pointed out, that had tribal issues. So I'm not sure that I would say that it's uniformly that the case law says only one thing.
Lal involves someone with a football-sized rock advancing, and they shot him. They found it reasonable. And, you know, the strangest case, which I'm not even sure I agree with, is Blanford, you know, with the gentleman who has the Civil War replica, and they shoot him for going into what ends up being his own home, and the court found that was reasonable. I know that a lot of panels distance themselves from Blanford because it's an older case, but the law case is close to this one it was a little bit more violent because the guy taking them on a high-speed chase and that, but he's advancing with a large rock. And the officers shoot him when he approached with the rock because the court found it was reasonable because he could throw the rock at him. And so there are, so when you get to Glenn, the case that that you talked about, he had never moved on anybody. He was only threatening himself with the knife. He was holding the knife, and he only moved when they beanbagged him. And then when they beanbagged him, he moved towards the home. And at that point, they fire. So a completely different scenario, because Napook was intentionally advancing on these officers. And he didn't verbally threat them, but when they said, "We're going to shoot you," he's like, "I know." You know, which
don't those statements suggest self-harm rather than harm on the officers?
Suicide by cop? Correct. I mean, there's all of these, but what it tells you is someone is willing to provoke a violent encounter to cause themselves harm, which a mentally ill person or a person trying to harm themselves can still cause substantial damage if they were to reach the officers. And they're very tragic cases. But in this case, you know, you have 5 minutes of lawful commands. You have officers repositioning, moving around, talking calmly, talking sternly, trying all of their training to get to a point to where they could just get the necessary resources there to help them. And it was his actions that provoked the need for deadly force, not the officers, which is the difference in Glenn and in Hayes. Because in Hayes, it's the officers that are going towards the suspect. They're the ones initiating the contact. And so that's where this case is markedly different, in my opinion.
Okay.
Thank you. Kemp,
we'll give you 2 minutes for rebuttal.
Thank you. So, Judge Sanchez, you asked about the taser, and in fact, that is the policy. One officer should be on lethal, in this case, to hit the gun, and another officer can be on taser. Otherwise, it might be an issue that both probes don't connect with the subject they're trying to tase. But in this case, Sergeant Kenton stated...
So, counsel, the challenge, I think, for the taser with somebody who's armed is, and if they're 1 second away from being able to cause injury to an officer, the problem with that, for saying that they have to use a taser, which would be effectively what your position would be, is that if it doesn't work, and we've had multiple cases where it doesn't work, then the other officer has 1 second to stop the person with a round that doesn't usually work very well to stop people, a firearm round, a handgun round, unless you shoot him in the head. Right.
Yeah.
So it's just, that is quite a standard. I mean, it starts to feel like we are sitting in an ivory tower and imposing sort of a very sterilized view, which is not what I saw when I saw the video.
Well, that's an interesting point, because Officer Gunn believed that Kenton was on taser, and yet he
fired. Well, he was for a brief moment, right? Like, he pulled his taser out and then he put it back away. But what I'm saying is, the reason it would seem to me to be very reasonable to think, you know what, this guy is within 10 feet of us, he can get to my partner within a second. And if my taser does not work, then I've got 1 second to pull out my handgun and to use it.
Yeah, well, as I understood it, the Officer Gunn believed that Kenton was on taser, and Kenton was discussing that in his deposition and in his statement, that he didn't want to use both hands. He didn't want to have one hand on the gun and one hand on the taser, because that's a violation of policy. And he didn't want to transition from gun to taser. It may take too much time. But irrespective of what he was thinking but didn't communicate to Officer Gunn, Gunn believed that he was on taser. I mean, he didn't say just for a second, he thought he was on taser. However, they both fired almost instantaneously, and they both fired at a point in time when...
That's the challenge with the taser thing. We've got other cases where somebody tries to tase, one of the officers tries, and the other officer fires almost immediately because the person's 1 second away, 1/1,000.
Yeah.
Like, that's all the time you have. So it's not like you can tase, sit there and analyze, did it work, and then fire. The officers are kind of put in this very challenging situation where they have to make literally a split-second decision as to whether or not the taser was effective. And it seems to me your argument is that is what is required for an officer to be reasonable.
Not necessarily, but in this case specifically, we're talking about time, distance, and cover. And Sergeant Napook had cover. He had the vehicle. He was behind the vehicle, and he stated...
So the interesting thing about this case is every time, you know, your argument is that they should have retreated more. But when I watch the video, every time they step back, that's when they get advanced on. Like, literally, like, every time they... So it's almost like, in obviously, hindsight being 20/20, it's almost like when they step back, they were almost, this guy was reacting by coming towards them. And so isn't it reasonable to think that if they'd have stepped back more, that he would have just continued advancing? Because literally, you know, when they go around the goes around the front of the car, the guy's advancing on the other officer. He turns around, sees that officer. He starts and he basically is advancing on them whenever they're retreating.
Towards the last 1 minute of the video, I agree with you, Judge Van Dyke. That's correct. He did seem to want to approach Sergeant Kenton.
Isn't that the relevant time period?
And they didn't shoot him before that.
Yeah. Well, by the way, I have to point out that this idea that de-escalation and talking calmly, Sergeant Kenton did employ that, and then he went to, "I'm going to shoot you."
Yeah, because they're trying everything. Like they're asking his name. They're trying to be aggressive. They're trying to be calm. They're trying to be calm first.
Right.
You see that from the video.
Yep.
I mean,
well, in a sense, I mean, when Officer Gunn approaches within 15 feet of Mr. Pook, he immediately gets out of his vehicle and aims the gun right at him. It says, "Drop whatever you're holding," in a very forceful command.
That's because, I mean, when you're watching the first officer's body cam video, the guy just appears, like, right there. I mean, I think all he did was pull his vehicle to the side of the road and jumped out.
He was in the dark. We didn't really see where he was. He was approaching. He did appear. But the initial commands to Mr. Napauk were pretty violent, pretty verbal, pretty forceful. And Kenton did try to de-escalate in a sense by asking him what his name was, et cetera. Nonetheless, he did threaten to shoot him very quickly. And the thing about the retreating, if they can safely reposition, tactically reposition, I understand they have no duty to retreat per se, but they can tactically reposition. And these vehicles were right there. There was nobody else around that was in danger. They had other backup. And instead of retreating, which he could have easily done behind... He retreated, yes, and that was his reason for not retreating again. He said, "I already gave up ground twice."
Your argument would go, if they'd retreated five times, you would have said, do it again.
Well, if it's feasible, you spend an hour dealing with somebody, and if you can save the life, if you can move away and create cover and distance and time.
I mean, I thought your argument was you could retreat because K-9's on its way, there's another officer that has a shotgun with a beanbag, you've got air support, you could start to contain the situation, there are no bystanders around, it's the middle of the night. So there could have been reasonably other options in order to bring this to a different conclusion with the presence of other officers.
And that's exactly the point. I was just saying, in general, the goal of a tactical team in a situation like this, when you've got somebody that's non-compliant, is to create time, distance, and cover so that they no longer are a credible threat to you. And the idea that...
But just to be clear, to apply that in this case would be to require that somebody continue retreating after they've tried. Officers continue retreating after they've already for minutes been retreating from somebody. And I think Judge Nelson's point, where's the stopping point? I mean, you conceded before you started with this that there's no duty to retreat, but... There would be then. There literally would be a duty to retreat, and not just to retreat, but keep on retreating until it's no longer possible to retreat.
Well, I think the policy now called tactically repositioning, and there is a duty to tactically reposition, especially when you know that somebody is not a criminal per se. He didn't commit any crime. No crime was committed.
Well, I'm not sure I totally agree with that. I mean, at least there's a probable cause of a crime being committed. I don't know how you would say there's not probable cause of a crime.
If I concede probable cause for the arrest, if you look at the case of Andrews versus City of Henderson, that doesn't give them the right to use excessive force in the process of the arrest. So let's say he did commit
not,
the...
Not on its face.
But it's relevant to reasonableness, yeah. Because if you're, you know, the question is, one of the questions is whether you're resisting arrest, and they're attempting to try to get him to drop the weapon, which would be a precursor to resisting arrest, and he's not doing it. Instead, he's advancing on them with the weapon.
Well... He's got headphones on. He's got sunglasses. We don't know what he can hear or see.
He's standing. Okay, I read that in your briefs, and then I went and watched the videos. He's standing right in front of a law enforcement vehicle with the lights on at night. There is no question, unless he's out of his mind, that he knows what's going on here.
I think at that moment in time, I think he probably was out of his mind. I mean,
And so then how does that play into, like, if you're a law enforcement officer and you've got somebody out of their mind with what looks like a 2-foot knife advancing on you?
It sounds very threatening. Judge Sanchez pointed out this is the whole key, because Officer Trudeau is right there. You can see it in the body cam with a low lethal shotgun. They asked for the 40-millimeter launcher. That was on its way as well, and the K-9. So they had all these tools that law enforcement officers have, not just a taser. They got OC spray. They got
until he got within 8 feet of them, in which case he's less than a second from being able to use a weapon on them. And you're saying, well, they still should. They should have what, turned around and literally started running the other way?
No, not really. All they had to do was all officer. Well, first of all, gun was safe.
Hey, he's gun right here. There's two vehicles right here. If he'd advanced forward and both of them went the opposite way in their car, now they're shooting at each other.
Yeah, you don't want crossfire for sure. I understand that. So, but all officer or Sergeant Kenton had to do was go behind. He was behind the Ford Explorer.
It sure sounds a lot like Monday morning quarterbacking to me.
No, I mean, he's a sergeant. He's tactically experienced. This is what he does. They encounter people that are mentally distressed all the time in Las Vegas. I mean, that's probably more than 70% of the people that get shot are people that are mentally ill. So he had time to go behind the Ford Explorer or go to the side or back up. Lloyd Nepuk was never walking at a fast pace. He was always calm, always walking slowly. He had his thumb in his pocket. He was holding this object.
But calm people can still use a weapon very quickly. So I think we've probably hashed this out about as much as we can at oral argument. We've given you a fair amount of extra time.
And I appreciate that.
Thank you. This is a case that the court is definitely looking closely at, and we appreciate both counsel for your helpful arguments today. And the case is now submitted, and that concludes
thank you very much.
Arguments for the day. Thank you.
Thank you.
All rise. This court for this session stands adjourned.